So today we'll continue with the Excel tips and tricks. So for the first step for today, this is something that which you have looked at in the past, but we didn't finish it. So we'll get to that first. So what I have here is, I have a few sets of values that are calculated from this particular data tab. So I have all the data in this sheet, and in the another sheet, I'm creating some formulas to get some summary values. So what's the total compensation in this department? How many employees are there here? It shouldn't be that, yeah. So how many employees are there, etc. Now, the task is, this particular values are calculated in a particular work we call Tips and Tricks Part 3. Now, I want to copy these same formulas into another sheet without having a link to this original workbook. So that's the task. And normally when you do this, I'll just copy this and I'll go to another workbook which I have, part 4, and I'll copy this here. So I got my values because I have I also have data sheet in this workbook. Let's assume this data and that data could be different, and we want the linking to happen from this sheet which is in this current workbook. Oftentimes this, but if you see these formulas, it's linking to the previous workbook and the data tab inside that workbook. So this could be sometimes what we would be looking for. Sometimes we may want that linking, sometimes we may don't want that linking. We want just go to the data tab which is in this workbook and refer data from there. So when we want that, what one roundabout way to get there is actually, so whenever we do copy pasting, it'll automatically give the linking for the previous workbook. So in order to avoid that, what we can do is go to the previous workbook again where we have values, and press Control tilde, so that will convert all the formulas, it will display all the formulas, Control tilde, and you copy these formulas from this form. You do Control C and go to a Notepad++, a new editor, okay, and paste these formulas here, and then do a second copy of these formulas from here. Go to your new workbook, part 4, and let me delete these for the time being and paste it here. So now you can see that the linking has been only from the data tab which is in the current workbook. So this is something, obviously at a small scale like this, it's much easier, but when you're dealing with copying pasting formulas in a large scale of sales cells, I think this would be a little helpful trick. So that is on the first step, and let me just switch few things.
This is just one question. The yes. Paste special also, does it have a formula option?
That's a good, let's explore that. Let me copy the values. Okay, I've copied them and I paste special. What I have here is, I have, we need to explore this a little bit, but I'm just seeing if there is anything that we can do on the top. Yes. Let's say formulas are there, okay, values, formats, all these are different things. I'm not so sure all these things are same. Let's try formulas. Now it looks like it we may have to explore the there sheet. Yeah, still referring.
Okay, if there's one more way of doing it, you can do a find and replace and remove the previous name,
right? So that's also another way. So for example, so I'll copy paste it again with these things linking to the previous workbook. What you can do is select these cells. Before that, you just select the value which we want to remove. So this is the part that is linking to the previous workbook. So I'll copy that and click escape, and I'll select these cells and go to my replace dialog box by pressing Ctrl H, and I'll paste that here. and replace that with just a empty cell. So, and that will automatically take care of the removing the linkage part. So this is one more way. Wherever sometimes one of the approaches will be more less time taking and more feasible than the other. So wherever it is the case, we can use both approaches. So that is
just a drawback of this approach. The second file should be open. Let's say if you copy paste and you close the previous file, you can't do a find and replace in this that case. It will give the whole directory path in that case.
Okay, understood. Okay, thanks, well. Okay, so moving on to the second tip. Let me just... Yeah, so my second tip is related to dates, actually, working with dates. So some of the tips here, so that whenever we are working with dates, it could be helpful. So let's say, for example, we all know the autofill option, right? So for example, if I say January 1st, let me do this, January 15th, 2020. Okay, and if I drag this automatically, I can expect my dates will proceed in that way. So, but let's say, for example, if I only want a particular day in a month, okay, mid-month, so only want 15th of each month, and I don't want 16th of January, but here my value should be 2nd February 15th. So I can do autofill. So this is something that with our intuition says, right? So normally you fill two values, give them in the selection, and then do a drag and drop, and we get the mid values, right? So this is one way to do it. Other quick way to do is sometimes actually this autofill option will give us some different results. Actually, normally it gave us luckily this result at this time, but sometimes it will give us very different results. Let me see if I can show that to you. It's giving us right values, but sometimes it will give you a very different values. Let me show here. I did the same thing here. So, but what happened is we can see these values. They are not exactly mid months. So when I did autofill, so sometimes it may happen like that. So one other quick way to get these mid months or any other date of a particular month is something like this. You don't even have to fill two values. You just get the enter the first value of the date which you want, and right click and drag, and it will give you this dialog box. I can say fill months, and it will automatically give us those particular mid months. And this can work with any date of the particular month. Let's say if I say 31st of 2020, and it will automatically, obviously many months will not have 31st, it will automatically reset it to the last day of that particular month. So we can say 29 and 30, all these dates. So this is one quick way to handle. And the other important similar autofill techniques on dates are, let me explain by this thing. Let's say we have today's date, which is 20 and 2021. Okay, and I will drag autofill to get certain dates. Okay, and let's say your task is to, hey, all this now currently I will get weekdays and weekend days, right? So Sunday to Monday, everything I'll get here. So let's say, for example, if you're doing a schedule, something similar to like KKS schedule, which have to be only scheduled on weekdays, we have to exclude weekends, right? So for that case, what you can do is either we can get the calculate the week day of this particular date, and then you either use a filter or something like that. That'll also work, but that's slightly time taking process. One quick way to get there is, so let me actually show display the dates here. So I'll paste the date here. I'll double click on it. One other quick way to just know the weekday of a particular date is may not be using formulas, but just by changing the format of the date. I just copy pasted the same date in this column, and I'll change the format to show me the day of the week. So I can just go to here. By pressing Control 1, I'll get to this format cells dialog box, and I'll go to custom format, and I'll press DDD. It'll give me a short form of the weekday. Four times I'll get the full form of the weekday. So I'll get all these days. But the issue with these things is these are just the format. So that means you cannot filter on these values. So if I let me do this, I'll show you. Let's say so we have values here, and now I'll do the same format. And once I apply the format, it will only be visible, but you will not be able to play with it. So for example, if I hover on this, the actual value is still the date, but we are just looking at it as a weekday. So when I filter on this, it will not be able to filter based on the weekdays. So that is something it's just the format. But what we can do is, one quick way to get only to get fill only for weekdays is something like this. Again, the right click option there. 20, 20, 21, and you right click and drag, and it will show you the option or several options here, just like fill months, fill weekdays alone, and it will have only weekdays popped up. Let's just see that. So we'll do that. Let's go back to Control 1, and I'll change the format to DDD. And you can see Monday, Friday, Monday to Friday, and Monday to Friday, and so on. So this is one way to get that done. And another one other tip related to dates and let me actually unhide these rows here. So if you can see here, we have a few sets of cells which are actually comprising these date values. So for example, here we have month field, day field, and year field, and all these three fields put together, we are creating these three values in different date formats. So here it's saying MDY, here month, year, date format, year, day, and month format. Oftentimes, and you can see these are not, though they are representing date information, they are not the date type, right? So oftentimes when we get this type of data where we have to work with, we can obviously use the date function, which will take the year, month, day. You can extract basically using right and left functions based on these cell references, and put in those inputs here so that we will convert these things into date. But that's a very long way. One quick way to do this, convert these string type of dates to actual date formats, is using a technique called, so you select the values which you want to convert, go to data, and select text to columns, okay, and select the delimited option, click next, and whatever the it doesn't matter what you choose here, click next, and you go here to select date, and based on the format, which is currently it is MDY, so I'll select MDY. We have other various options as well. I'll select MDY and click finish, and it'll automatically convert all of those things, parse those things into actual date. So I can do this with any of the six formats that are possible with both these three. So that is YDM. So I will select this and click finish, and I have all the same dates again here. So those are like a few simple tricks on dates which could be helpful. And let me move on to my next set of tips, which is related to something called as wildcards. Okay, let me explain. So let's assume that you have some set of unique ID or customer ID or any identification number which you have to use for which you come across any data, and let's assume that this ID that you're dealing with has some information in it. So let's say the way that it is encoded has some information with it, and we want to, let's say, find out, hey, I want all of them all the IDs where my fourth digit is either is a specific alphanumeric code, either a 2 or Q, whatever it is, right? So if I come here and if I have to filter based on that, obviously there are several different ways to achieve that. I can extract that fourth value and as a new column using formulas, and then based on that I can filter. That'll also work, but one quick way to do that is using the wildcards. So let's say, so what I want is, I want my fourth letter to be, let's say 2. And I don't care the first, the second and third, it could be anything. So since it could be anything, I'll put the question mark, question mark, question mark in those three places, okay? First, actually, let me not get here. Let's go to text filters and begins with, yeah. So begins with, it could begin with anything in the first three letters, and my fourth letter has to be 2. Okay, and I'll click OK, and I immediately can see that it has filtered. So wherever we are, all these rows have fourth letter as 2. So that is something. So using question marks, we can get that. And I can also apply the same thing here, but it's a slightly different one. Let me just see how many rows are there here. So there are 206 rows. So let me clear this filter. And if I have to get the same using this text filter, it's a slightly different format we need to use. So for example, I'll go with the same wildcard. I'll put this and I'll put 2 as my fourth letter, but when I did that, you can see that it's showing no matches, right? So the reason for that is, but we just saw that there are 206 values which with this format, but the difference between the previous begins with filtering and this filtering is that begins with filtering will only look for cells which are starting with that particular format which you have specified, criteria which you have specified, but here it is looking for an exact match. So it's not just looking at the first four letters, but it is looking at everything else. And in order to let this format function here, what we need to give is we need to make use of another wildcard which is called asterisk. So what it tells is, wherever you use question mark, it's basically telling that hey, that character could be anything, I don't know about that. And asterisk basically means that after this particular alphabet, which is 2 in our case, it could be followed with any number of letters, and those number of letters could be anything. So that is the, and using that condition, basically, it is meeting all these values, the 206 values which we saw, because obviously we don't know what follows that after fourth letter being 2. So we just put asterisk there, and which will give us again the same 206 amount of values which we saw earlier. So this is, we can use these two wildcards in filtering wherever required. One other thing, so these two wildcards, instead so Excel interprets the wherever you use question mark and asterisk as a differently. So whenever we have to work with question mark and asterisk, we need to be a little careful. Let's say, for example, we have these four values here, and I have a few question marks and asterisk embedded in them. And let's say I want to replace these values with some other value that I want. I obviously know how replace works. So if I, let's say, for example, there is a D here. If I do, if I replace D, my D will be replaced with whatever the text that I want. But if I try to do the same with, let's say, question mark, okay, and I will try to replace with a blank value, right? Look what happens. So what it has happened is, so it has removed out everything. It's not as expected. The reason being, Excel is treating this as a wildcard entry, and it's making sure that if the cell has any value in it, it's just replacing that with the blank value. So in order to achieve what we want, that is to only, let me just do Control Z, and just to replace those values, there is a particular format Excel wants us to follow. When we are dealing with wildcard entries like question mark and asterisk, you have to put in a tilde symbol before and after, and when you do replace now it will basically take care of those, and I can do the same with asterisk, and I'll do replace all, and those values have been changed. So that is one thing when you are dealing with that. And also this particular wildcards can also be used in formulas. Okay, let's say we all some of you may be aware of the COUNTIF function, right? COUNTIF, SUMIF, all those functions. And basically what it will give me is based on a certain criteria, it will count all the cell, how many cell values are passing that criteria, and it will give me the count of that. So let me just COUNTIF, and I can use those wildcard entry here as well. So let's say I select this column as a range, and my criteria here is again the same criteria. Hey, my fourth letter should be some specific value. So I'll give first, second, third. My fourth should be, let's say, 2. And after that, it's okay. It can be followed by any number of alphanumeric values. And I'll click OK and press Enter. And I got my 206 values, which I saw earlier. So yeah, so these are, it actually allows a lot more flexibility. If anyone of you are interested, you can explore more on this.
Jagadish, a quick question here. If you want to find, how many of those unique identifiers have question marks in it? So in that case, how can we?
I think you have to, at the moment, it doesn't have. Let me just do. Okay. So one way to do about this, let's say all these four have question marks. And let me put COUNTIF and select these. You can do asterisk, let me do this. Yeah, asterisk, it should start with anything else. I think tilde, I'm also not sure, I'm just trying out here. Okay, and it can follow with any number of alphanumeric codes, and I'll click this, see if it works. 0, okay, then let me try with single quotation.
There's probably some sort of an escape sequence.
Character. Right, yeah, that we need to look at.
If you want to say that that single quotes or something, usually that.
So, okay, let's just do this then. I don't think it will. Yeah, so we need to basically identify how can we pass. I think not sure what that escape sequence, what Sai was mentioning. I think that's the key here. Once we find that out, I think we'll be able to pass this. Sometimes it will be backslash or something. I'm not so sure, but I may have to explore further there. Sai, Akhil. Okay, so that's on the wildcards. I think we're already at 10. We can hold this here and continue.
Just try this. Try that.
Yes.
With the tilde symbol. See if it works.
Okay.
COUNTIF.
Yeah.
Just tilde. Yeah. Before it.
Only before.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Do you want me to go with asterisk or only just this?
No, just this.
Okay.
Still not working. Okay.
Yeah. Let's try. Oh, now it's working. Okay, it's just the beginning one.
Right.
Okay, so that's the key. Okay, so let me just remove question marks here. The first one, so it should make 3. Yeah, okay, thanks. So it's the tilde is the escape key, but here we only use the beginning of it.
Okay.
Okay. Any further questions? I think we will close it here. But if you have any questions, we'll